Thank you, Minister. Before we move to the next item of business, members will wish to join me in welcoming to the gallery His Excellency Mr. Sungnam Lin, the Ambassador of the Republic of Korea to the United Kingdom. Thank you. We now move to First Minister's questions. Question one, Kezia Dugdale.
To ask the First Minister what engagements she has planned for the rest of the day.
First Minister.
Engagements to take forward the Government's programme for Scotland.
Kezia Dugdale.
Thank you. Earlier this week, the Education Secretary put her hands up and admitted that after 8 years of SNP government, the attainment gap between children from deprived and wealthy areas shows no sign of closing. Perhaps this is a new willingness by the SNP to come clean about their education failures. So let's put that theory to the test. In this chamber, on the 13th of May, Angela Constance said, and I quote, "For the record, it is important to recognise there has been no reduction in bursaries." So just for the record, Presiding Officer, can the First Minister confirm whether the amount of money spent on student bursaries and grants in Scotland has gone up or down since the SNP took office in 2007?
First Minister.
Well, can I say firstly to Kezia Dugdale, no issue is more important to me and no issue is more important to this government than our education system. And I will not hold back from being open about where improvements are needed, but equally I won't hold back from challenging those who seek to paint an inaccurate picture of Scottish education, because I think that does a disservice to the achievements of young people and teachers across the country. So when Kezia Dugdale says that the gap between those in the most deprived communities and those in the least deprived communities is growing, that is not true. If you look at qualifications, for example, fewer people are leaving school now with no qualifications than was the case in 2007. And more pupils are leaving school not just with one, two or three hires, but with four, five or six or more hires. And that's true not just overall, but that is true also of those in the most deprived parts of our country. So I think there is work to do in our education system, and I don't make any bones about that. But I'm not going to allow any politician in any party to traduce the achievements of our pupils. Now, coming to the specific question about bursaries, I think it was the National Union of Students some time ago who described the support package for students in Scotland as being the best in the UK. That support package is a mixture of loans and bursaries, but that support package stands comparison with that of other parts of the UK. So as in this area of policy, as in all other areas of education policy, I will stand on the achievements of this government, but I will also openly and honestly say where there is more work needed, this government will not shy away from doing it.
Yeah. Okay,
Presiding Officer, I asked the First Minister very specifically about bursaries and grants. And the reality is that since the SNP took office in 2007, bursaries and grants for students have been slashed by £40 million. That's £40 million less for students who have the talent to get on in life but don't have the financial resources of their better-off peers. It's thousands of working-class kids who have the grades to be nurses, engineers and doctors but can't get the extra support they need unless they borrow more. So how does that compare to the situation elsewhere? Can the First Minister tell the Chamber which country in the UK provides the lowest level of bursaries for low-income students?
First Minister.
Kezia Dugdale, last week at First Minister's question, I assume inadvertently misrepresented the position she was trying to put forward in terms of qualifications. I fear she's doing the same today, because what matters to students is the support package that is provided. And the reality is this government has exceeded the manifesto commitment we made to support the poorest students by ensuring a minimum income of £7,500 in maintenance support for students. There was a 24% increase in the value of the average support package between 2012-13, 2013-14, up from £4,320 in 2012-13. Also, the average student loan debt for Scottish students is lower than the average debt of students in England, in Wales and in Northern Ireland. So on all of these measures, we are delivering on the commitments that we made to the poorest students in our society. And perhaps that is why we are able to stand here and say that we have not just met, as I said last week, but exceeded our commitment to maintain full-time equivalent numbers in our colleges. It is why we are starting to see an increase in the number of students from the most deprived communities in Scotland go to university. That is not good enough, which is why we have set up our Widening Access Commission. So this is a government, unashamedly, presiding officer, that will defend the achievements, not just of the government, but of students, pupils and teachers across our country, but will also be open to where we need to do better. One of the issues I am sure the Widening Access Commission will look at is how we further and better support students, particularly those from our most deprived areas, so that they can take full advantage of the excellent education services that we provide.
Kezia Dugdale.
That might have been a speech, Presiding Officer, but it certainly wasn't an answer.
Order.
Do you know, I've never...
Order, Mr. Swinney.
I've never heard the First Minister be so reluctant to say the word Scotland, because that's the answer. Under the SNP, it's Scotland that has the lowest level of bursaries and grants across the whole of the United Kingdom. And the SNP know this because they were embarrassed into making an announcement about it last week. And that extra announcement was £2.40 a week. The idea that that's going to transform things is laughable. It's not enough money to get from here to Heriot Watt and back. It's a disgrace. In 2007, the SNP campaigned on a manifesto to wipe out student debt. I've got the leaflet here. And on the back of it, it says, student debt, it'll lurk around your home like a bad smell on the landing. Well, it's clearly lurking around the SNP government. Can the First Minister confirm whether student debt has gone up or down under the SNP?
First Minister.
Well, I appreciate that Kezia Dugdale didn't like the detailed answer that I gave her, but that's no
order.
Reason for me to continue to fulfil the duty I have in this chamber to give detailed answers, even if they don't suit the political purposes of the Scottish Labour Party. In my last answer, I addressed specifically the issue of student loan debt. Average student loan debt for Scottish students in 2014, £7,600, compared to, in England, £20,100. In Northern Ireland, £16,820. And perhaps most significant of all, Presiding Officer, in Wales, where there is a Labour government, average student loan debt in Wales was £17,310. So I think if I was a Scottish student, of course I would look to the government I lead to continue to make improvements and to do better. I would expect nothing less. But I think if I was a student in Scotland, I'd prefer to be in Scotland with average student loan debt so much lower than it is anywhere else in the United Kingdom. But can I also finally say this to Kezia Dugdale? For the party that introduced tuition fees in Scotland, for the party that broke a manifesto commitment to introduce tuition fees in England, for a party that broke a manifesto commitment not to introduce top-up tuition fees to do precisely that, I think it is sheer and utter hypocrisy for Labour to come to this chamber and talk about student debt. And interestingly,
order.
The only people that were clapping at the end of Kezia Dugdale's last contribution were the Tories. I'm reminded of Michael Duggar, the senior UK Labour figure, the comments he made last week about Labour. We shouldn't have been in bed with the Tories. It was a complete disaster. It killed us. I think it's about time Kezia Dugdale and Labour learned a few lessons.
Kezia Dugdale.
President Officer, it was the Labour Party that abolished tuition fees in 2001. No. She should wait for the answer.
Order!
She should wait for the answer. It was the Labour Party that abolished tuition fees in 2001, and I say that to the First Minister. I say that to the First Minister in the most sincere way, because I was at... I know they don't like it, but the reality is I was at university when this Labour Party abolished fees in 2001. And far from dumping the debt, Presiding Officer, I've got the figures in front of me here. It has doubled under the SNP. It has doubled. According to our own government figures, the average debt per student has doubled under the SNP. And a leading education expert says a student from a low-income background in Scotland now faces debts up to £27,000. That's the SNP's record when it comes to student loan debt, and that's more than the average annual salary in Scotland, Presiding Officer. So in truth, the SNP's time in office has been a mixture of ups and downs. Student debt is up and student bursaries are down. In light of the SNP's new transparent approach in education, when will the First Minister just admit that she's letting down Scotland's students?
First Minister.
Can I say to Kezia Dugdale, just because she says something in a sincere way doesn't make it true. Labour.
Order!
Labour removed tuition fees from the front end of education and put them on the back end of education. That's not abolishing tuition fees. Now, I know Labour lives in a parallel universe these days, and who can blame them? Because the real universe for Scottish Labour is a pretty miserable place to be. But trying to pretend they abolished tuition fees, Presiding Officer, really takes the biscuit. And perhaps it's insulting the intelligence of the Scottish people in that way that has resulted in Labour being in the dire position it is in today. You know, I will continue to do the job that I've got to do in making improvements where we need to make those improvements. That's precisely why we have established the Widening Access Commission, to look at how we make it possible for more students from our most deprived areas to go to university. And we will reflect on and implement the recommendations of that commission so that we can build on our achievements and make sure that we are serving the students and the potential students of this country even better in future. And I make that commitment most sincerely, Presiding Officer. But can I say finally to Kezia Dugdale, she might want to describe the SNP's term in office as being one of ups and downs. If only she could describe Labour's term in opposition that way, because it hasn't been one of ups and downs, it has been one of downs. And if they keep up the performance that we're seeing week after week, they'll be going down even further.
Ruth Davidson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, to ask the First Minister when she will next meet the Prime Minister.
First Minister.
No current plans.
Ruth Davidson.
Thank you. It seems that we all now agree, the Education Secretary this week included, that our school system is failing too many of our children. We have declining standards in literacy and numeracy and a persistent gap between better and worse off children. And these are simply facts, First Minister. We know that the Education Secretary wants to tackle this, but the truth is we have no idea what she wants to do. So I'd like to ask a very specific question. In her speech earlier this week, the Education Secretary said that she was studying Denmark and Ontario to see what lessons could be learned from their education systems. Both have a rigorous system of testing primary school and younger secondary school children. So does the Scottish Government now support reintroducing standardised testing?
First Minister.
Well, let me deal with that question in a very serious way, because it is a serious question. Firstly, can I just correct Can I just correct Ruth Davidson on one point? Because I agree with her that there are improvements required to be made in our education system. I've said that consistently every time this issue has been raised with me. But it is simply not true. If you look, for example, at qualifications gained, to say that standards in our education system are falling. I've got details here of exam passes going back to 2007, covering every decile of the Scottish population. Fewer pupils today are leaving school with no qualifications than was the case in 2007. If you look at hires, more people, as I said to Kezia Dugdale, are leaving school, not just with one, two or three hires, but with four hires, five hires, six or more hires. You know, in 2007, just 20% from our most deprived decile left school with at least one hire. It's now 33%. That is nowhere near good enough, but it's not true to say that things are not going in the right direction. But there are improvements that require to be made, and that is why we have a serious and substantial programme of work underway, one that I, with the Education Secretary, am overseeing personally. We have established the Attainment Challenge, the £100 million Attainment Fund, that is initially going to work with primary schools in seven local authority areas focused on literacy, numeracy, health and wellbeing. The Scottish Government is currently working with these local authorities to finalise their improvement plans and the detail of how these improvement plans will be monitored and measured. We're in the process of appointing attainment advisers in every local authority area. We're investing in the Read, Write, Count campaign. And we are, and this comes substantially to the point Ruth Davidson made to me, we are also working on a new national performance framework, because I don't mind admitting a frustration that I can stand here and I can give detail on the performance of secondary school pupils in terms of exam passes. It's much more difficult to do that in terms of the performance of primary school pupils because of a lack of data. That's something I want to address. I want to address that in a serious, proportionate and well thought out way. That is the work that's underway within the Scottish Government, and Parliament, of course, will be kept fully updated.
Ruth Davis.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. In among that litany of exam results, what we haven't had is the acknowledgement that the biannual literacy testing this year shows that standards in literacy are down. The biannual numeracy testing last year showed that standards are down. And since the First Minister came to post, we've heard a lot about how much she's listening, how nothing's off the table, that people can bring forward ideas, that they'll look at things. And it's wearing a bit thin, because we actually need some decisions and we need a plan. Audit Scotland told us last year there is no rigorous method in Scotland for assessing children's standards, because some councils do it and some councils don't. Its report states, and if I could quote, Presiding Officer, at a council level, there is no consistent approach to tracking and monitoring the progress of pupils from primary one to S3. So that means that after 8 years of this government, until your child is 14 years old, you have no clear idea how good their education is in comparison to the rest of the country. And it's no wonder the Scottish Government doesn't know what to do, because it doesn't know what's going on. So we do need that new system of primary testing, exactly like Denmark and exactly like Ontario, so that we can all see which schools need help and which schools are leading the way. Frameworks are fine, but enough is enough. Will you get on and introduce primary testing or not?
First Minister.
Well, firstly, much of what Ruth Davidson said in that question simply repeated what I'd already said in my first answer to her first question. I openly acknowledge that while we do have, through exam passes, a wealth of data about the performance of secondary school pupils, we do not have that same data on primary school pupils. I think she then went on to overstate it by saying that parents have no idea how their children are doing in primary schools. But she's also wrong to say that there's been no acknowledgement of the fact that in the recent SSLN survey, standards on literacy and numeracy had showed a decline. I have openly acknowledged that and said very clearly that is not acceptable, and that is what we are now working to improve. There is a serious and substantial programme of work underway. I'm not, though, going to simply to give Ruth Davidson a yes or a no answer, jump to the decisions before we have properly considered what the right thing to do is. We do need a new national performance framework, but we need to make sure that the data we are collecting and the way in which we are doing that is right, proportionate and sensible. We are considering these issues at the moment, and I look forward, and the Education Secretary look forward, to updating Parliament very soon on the direction in which we want to go. You know, I've said repeatedly in this chamber, and I'm going to say again today, I appreciate that the opposition parties will want to be political about this issue. I accept that. I am determined that we make the improvements in our education system that require to be made. So I, with Angela Constance, with the entire government, are going to roll up our sleeves and do the hard work that needs to be done to do right by the young people of Scotland. And I make no apology to anyone for that.
Question three, Willie Rennie.
To ask the First Minister what issues will be discussed at the next meeting of the Cabinet.
First Minister.
Matters of importance to the people of Scotland, no doubt including some of the issues we've just been discussing.
Willie Rennie.
I'm pleased that the First Minister accepts that attainment in literacy and numeracy is falling in Scotland on her watch. It is therefore the responsibility of everyone in this chamber to bring forward ideas for change. We argued for an expansion in early learning and childcare. The government opposed our proposals, but we eventually won them round. Yet our proposals on the pupil premium have been repeatedly dismissed as unnecessary by successive education ministers, happy to argue that everything was fine. So now that it is clear that everything is not fine, will she finally agree to introduce the pupil premium in Scotland?
First Minister.
If Willie Rennie or any other member of this chamber puts forward ideas for how we improve our education system, of course, we will consider those. I would say to Willie Rennie, though, that per pupil spending in Scotland in both our primary schools and in our secondary schools is higher already than it is in England, where the pupil premium was introduced and has increased under this SNP government. I think there's a number of things we need to do. And, you know, as I said, both to Kezia Dugdale and to Ruth Davidson, I really do think it's incumbent on opposition politicians in seeking rightly to hold the government to account that they don't in the process deny the achievements of our education system, because it is simply not true to try to paint a picture of a system that is universally failing. As I have demonstrated through reference to the exam statistics, the opposite is the case. But on literacy and numeracy, we recognise there are improvements that require to be made. You know, Willie Rennie talks about pupil premium and what that means is increased funding. I've already announced an additional £100 million focused on seven local authority areas, and within those seven local authority areas, on the pupils who live in our most deprived communities. That's putting money where our mouth is, making the investment available, but then making sure that that investment is used to deliver the things that will make a difference in our schools, and then finally that we can measure and monitor the difference that has been made so that we know what works and what doesn't work. That is the kind of systematic, robust, rigorous way we will go about this. I hope we can persuade others to come on side with us here, and we will, of course, continue to listen to any ideas that are put forward.
Will there any?
I'm disappointed that she won't accept this, because in England, the pupil premium has closed the gap in attainment for primary school children. It allows for one-to-one tuition, books, equipment and targeted support that children from disadvantaged backgrounds need. She talks about the Scottish Government Attainment Fund, but it is limited to 7 out of 32 council areas. The pupil premium would be for the whole country. Will the First Minister finally just agree, accept the case, that the pupil premium closes the gap in attainment and it should be introduced in Scotland?
First Minister.
Look, £100 million attainment fund focused on the local authorities, where I think everybody accepts the biggest concentrations of people living in our most deprived communities are. It may be that some of them, this is something we're actively looking at just now, that some of that money goes to other local authorities where there are clusters of deprivation in particular areas. But surely it is right, having set aside that substantial financial investment, to make sure that that investment is being focused exactly where it is needed most, so that we can drill down on where the issues are and make sure we have that rigorous approach in place to making improvements and monitoring improvements. You know, I am absolutely determined that we focus on this. We will not close our minds to ideas that are brought forward. Of course we will consider ideas, but we have put in place a serious and substantial programme of work, and we are determined to get on with implementing that, because that's what parents and teachers across the country expect, and that is what they will get from this government.
Question 4, Kenneth Gibson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the First Minister what discussions the Scottish Government has had with the UK Government regarding the safety of Trident nuclear submarines.
First Minister.
Well, the Scottish Government has made clear its opposition to Trident nuclear weapons and our concern about the risks they pose. However, the MOD does not discuss the operation of its Vanguard-class submarines with the Scottish Government. Recent allegations from a whistleblower highlighting a catalogue of safety breaches and security lapses are gravely concerning. The UK Government, I think, must fully investigate these allegations without delay, explain any failings that have been highlighted, and set out as far as they can precisely what has been done to address each one. People across Scotland and indeed across the UK, and not least those who live and work at or around the naval base on the Clyde, must have answers to the very serious allegations that have been raised.
Kenneth Gibson.
Thank the First Minister for that answer. Whilst many people are indeed concerned following revelations in nuclear engineer William McNeely's 18-page report, The Nuclear Secrets, which came to light last Sunday, does she agree that whilst the Royal Navy is denying a host of allegations ranging from fire risks to near sinking and collision with another submarine, a fully and comprehensive safety review is indeed merited and should take place with immediate effect? And do such concerns not make clear that ensuring public safety is yet another reason why it would be folly to squander billions on renewing Trident?
First Minister.
Public safety must always be the top priority, and as I've already said, I think we do need a top-level inquiry into the allegations that have been made. Any potential safety or security failings of the Trident nuclear weapons system are an extremely grave matter. The government has long opposed the existence of these weapons, but we've also raised operational and safety concerns in the past as well. But the allegations that were raised over the last few days, I think, are all the more troubling because they've been raised by a member of defence personnel, and therefore they've got to be treated with the seriousness that they deserve. I think only the fullest possible assurance from the UK Government of the safety of its arrangements is now acceptable. However, I think we should also be very clear that the only certain way to remove the risk of an incident involving Trident nuclear weapons is through the withdrawal of Trident nuclear weapons. And the UK Government should, in my view, cancel its irresponsible plans to spend £100 billion on renewing these weapons of mass destruction and should begin now to plan for their removal.
Question 5, Neil Findlay.
To ask the First Minister what progress the Scottish Government is making on increasing the number of companies and organisations paying the living wage.
First Minister.
The Scottish Government has provided funding to the Poverty Alliance to promote the living wage and increase the number of accredited employers in Scotland. Their work resulted in the achievement of the original target of 150 living wage accredited employers 8 months early, and now they're working towards a new target of 500 accredited employers by the end of March next year.
Neil Findlay.
This week's BBC Scotland Investigates documentary showed the heartbreaking impact of low pay on people's lives. The responsibility for setting the national minimum wage is, of course, reserved to the UK Government. But this government can do much, much more now to address low pay. With only 10 out of 50 of Scotland's largest employers paying the living wage, will the First Minister now publish an action plan setting out how her government intends using the powers it has to raise the incomes and living standards of Scottish workers?
First Minister.
I'm not going to set out an action plan. I'm going to continue to ensure that we take the actions that we are already agreed need to be taken. You know, I think less talk and more action on things like this are what we need. We have funded the Poverty Alliance. That campaign has already delivered 200 living wage accredited employers. Monday of this week, BrewDog was confirmed as the 200th. That's a significant increase since this time last year, and it shows that employers from every sector of the economy recognise the importance of ensuring that working people are receiving a fair level of pay. And we will now support the Poverty Alliance to reach that new target of 500 accredited employers. We will also continue to lead by example as a living wage employer, making sure that we take that action with our subcontractors as well and encourage other public authorities to do so. I do agree with Neil Findlay about how upsetting watching the documentary he refers to was. I passionately believe that people deserve to earn a living wage when they do a decent day's work, and we in this government will continue to do everything we possibly can to make sure that's the case.
Question 6, Kevin Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the First Minister what action the Scottish Government is taking to allow more disabled people to access modern apprenticeships.
First Minister.
I think this is an important issue. Right now, the number of disabled people accessing modern apprenticeships is disproportionately low, so addressing what is an underrepresentation is a key priority for the Government. Through funding that we provided last year, Skills Development Scotland is working with Barnardo's and Remploy on specific early targeted pathway projects to help disabled young people enter into a modern apprenticeship, and we're undertaking research to better understand the issues that prevent disabled people from participating in this programme. And this work will be used to develop an equalities action plan by autumn 2015, supported by funding of £500,000 that was announced last week to address equality issues in the modern apprenticeship programme.
Kevin Stewart.
Thank you. I welcome that answer. I know many public bodies and companies benefit greatly from employing disabled people. What can the government do to persuade more employers that taking on young people with learning and physical disabilities as apprentices could be positive not only for the employees, but highly advantage for their companies?
First Minister.
Firstly, we should seek to encourage employers, as many already do, to see the enormous contribution that people with disabilities can make to the workplace, to society, to our wider economy. More particularly, we're currently developing a new employer recruitment incentive which will support vulnerable young people, including young people with a disability. This incentive is aimed at supporting young people into sustainable employment and encouraging and equipping small businesses to recruit young modern apprentices into their workforce. We're also going to identify a lead body to support recruitment of young disabled people, to develop a new work experience model for young disabled people, and introduce an improved approach to career services for young disabled people. And all of that is detailed in the Developing Our Young Workforce Implementation Plan. So I think Kevin Stewart raises a serious issue and one that we're determined to continue to address.
Thank you. That ends First Minister's questions. Point of order, James Kelly.
I raise a point of order, Presiding Officer, on the basis that in the session that we've just seen, the party leader exchanges took 25 minutes. Therefore, the backbench, there wasn't an appropriate opportunity for backbenchers to participate in FMQs and hold the government properly to account. I therefore ask, Presiding Officer, that you use your offices to ensure that the party leader exchanges take up an appropriate length of time, and I would encourage the First Minister to restrict our exchanges to answers.
To restrict
our contributions to answers as opposed to speeches.
Thank you for your point of order, Mr Kelly. Can I say that I always have the interest of the backbenchers at heart. I will look very carefully at the exchanges today. It certainly seemed the party leaders' exchanges were quite long. Once I review that, I will do as I usually do, Mr Kelly, and I will speak to you as a business manager, and I will speak to all the other business managers about how we can manage First Minister's questions better next week. We now move to members' business. Members who leave the chamber should do so quickly and quietly.